Hello all. Today I'd like to talk about military money and how powerful it is. Military money, or defense contracting, is one of the most powerful elements in government. But I would argue that we don't quite realize the full picture. Today I'd like to lay that out. Now, we've already covered elsewhere how defense contracting works. A company has a large, massive project of some sort that they want to implement, so they make sure to divide the project up between as many jurisdictions as possible. That way, they make the program immortal. If you've got a piece in every state of the United States, that program is never going to die, because the senators and congresspeople from those states will make sure that it lasts forever. That's how we end up with a $1 trillion program for a fighter jet that doesn't fight things very well. But to see the true dimensions of the power of military money, we're going to have to step back and take a look at the broader economy and the very powerful and unique role that defense spending has within that economy. It may not seem that way, but 21st century capitalism has a lot of rules. We have things like the World Trade Organization and a whole bunch of other multilateral or just bilateral treaties and organizations that limit the ways that government can help business. At least in principle, there's an even playing field between companies from different countries. The World Trade Organization even has a system of tribunals that enforce this sort of thing. Now, in practice, this of course does not work perfectly. Every developed country, and now more and more developing countries, have all kinds of systems and strategies that they use to work around this. There are all kinds of tax incentives and subsidies, and, well, basically they're always coming up with new ways to try and get around these things. And don't even get me started about the way that in the United States, you've got like 80% of the people running big companies and running the government who all went to the same 4 or 5 schools. But no matter how imperfectly all of this works, the principles are there, the rules are there, and they have to be followed, or at least they have to appear to be followed. This is not the way it works for defense spending, and I'm not arguing that it should. It makes sense that there are carve-outs in all of these regulations and organizations that state specifically that none of these rules apply to defense industries. If it comes down to the defense of a country, then that country needs to do what it feels that it needs to do to defend itself. That makes sense. But we need to recognize the privileged position that this puts defense contractors in. We need to recognize how powerful this makes military money. There are a whole range of international organizations that govern military technology. But what these international organizations do is actually the opposite of what the World Trade Organization does. The World Trade Organization tries to make trade freer, tries to make the playing field more even for businesses generally. What the organizations that deal with the arms industry do on the international level and on the local level, on the local of individual national governments, what they do is they make trade less free. This makes it harder for new companies that want to implement defense technologies, but it makes things much, much easier for the established players. On the international level, there's this thing called the Wassenaar Arrangement. It's not an agreement, it's an arrangement. All of the countries with large military manufacturing industries are members of this arrangement. They report all of their sales to this organization. Everything from bullets to missile technology is reported and discussed and dealt with to some degree. Now, of course, there are illegal arms dealers, but it's much harder to access these channels of sales if you want to be an above-board defense contractor. From here on in, I'm mostly going to talk about the United States, but I want to emphasize that this is not just a U.S. problem. France, the United Kingdom, Russia, China, and a whole bunch of other countries have massive defense industries, and they have similar setups within their government. They have similar shady arrangements between defense contractors and legislators. It's a problem across the world. Of course, the United States has the biggest military, so we have the biggest problem. So, drilling down to the United States, there's a massive export control regime. There are multiple government agencies that are party to this scheme, to this export control. State Department does some stuff. Defense Department does some stuff. there's a lot going on. There's this incredible thicket of regulations that governs who you can sell to, why you can sell to. All of this doesn't actually slow things down. It just makes the relationship tighter. If the government wants to sell $15 billion worth of fighter jets to Saudi Arabia, it's going to happen. But all of these export controls add complexity, and they make the big defense contractors much, much safer. If you want to sell a new tank, it's not like you can just build a new tank. You need teams of lawyers. You need teams of bureaucrats. You need teams of executives that can interact with the government. This is, of course, a pain, but it makes the big companies much, much safer. And once again, there absolutely should be an export control regime when it comes to military systems. But in the United States, at least, it goes much, much further than that. The United States operates a foreign military sales program. This means that the Department of Defense isn't just subsidizing military contractors, isn't just buying a ton of their stuff. The Department of Defense actually acts as a sales department for military contractors. U.S. government personnel end up actively selling these weapon systems to other countries. U.S. military personnel end up delivering these systems, and in a lot of cases, they end up training foreign militaries on the use of these weapons systems. For some of this, I'm sure there's a very legitimate national security interest, but we're talking about billions and billions of dollars a year. This is a program that very few people even know anything about. This is pretty extraordinary. In most industries, if a government wants to support that industry, they have to be kind of sneaky. They've got to come up with some kind of justification. They've got to fiddle with the tax code or something like that. In the defense industry, the government is actively selling the products of the industry. It doesn't even really make sense to call this capitalism. It's actually socialism, pure and simple. So think about what this means for a second. Say you're a U.S. congressperson from Kentucky, or you're a French member of parliament from a region or whatever it is they have. Who are you going to be more interested in talking to? Are you going to be interested in talking to and doing things for a bathtub company that has a bathtub factory they'd like to put in your region? I mean, sure, you want them to put that bathtub factory in your region, but no matter how many tax subsidies or incentives you give to that bathtub factory, if somebody, say China, figures out how to make a cheaper bathtub, it doesn't matter. That factory is going to disappear. On the other hand, you could form a relationship with a defense contractor. This defense contractor is going to have government on its side and on your side through every step of the interaction. Government will help put the factory in. Government will help sell the things that that factory makes. And there's no question of foreign competition when it comes to weapon systems. I should have made this clear earlier, but I think it's just common sense that a government isn't going to want to buy weapons from another country or components of complex technological weapons systems from other countries unless it has to. A lot of that is written into law in the United States. So if you're a congressperson who has a relationship with a defense contractor, they're going to be your friend forever. They're not going to go anywhere. The government says so. And if it looks like that's going to change, you're a congressperson. You can make sure it doesn't. And that's why military money is so much more powerful than any other kind of money in the broader economy. The defense industry, the military-industrial complex, isn't just one of our country's biggest industries. It's also, certainly, our country's most protected industry. In fact, it's probably one of the most effective jobs programs that the United States government runs. If we want to talk seriously about the U.S. government and U.S. military's role in the world, or its role in U.S. politics, we have to look at these facts honestly. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe. And if you'd like to help me make more videos like this one, please click on the Patreon link here to find out how.